In this video, we're computing an integral that requires us to use a trig substitution followed by integration by parts. So we're looking at the integral of the inverse cosine function as x goes from 0 to 1. And the first thing we start with here is the trig substitution. We're going to let x equal cosine theta so that the inverse cosine undoes the cosine. We transform the differential and find that dx is equal to negative sine theta d theta. And we're going to transform the limits of integration as well. So when x equals 0, that means 0 is equal to cosine theta. That happens at theta equals pi over 2. And when x equals 1, that means the cosine of theta is equal to 1, so theta is equal to 0. So our integral transforms to the integral from pi over 2 to 0 times the inverse cosine of the cosine of theta, and that's going to simplify to theta. And then my differential dx transformed to a negative sine theta d theta, and I'm going to go ahead and pull the minus sign out in front of the whole thing. And we clean things up a bit. First, we can reverse the limits of integration, and that undoes the minus sign out in front. And again, the inverse cosine of theta is just theta. And I end up with the integral of theta sine theta d theta. And this is a classic integration by parts integral. In the integration by parts, we let u equal theta. And the whole point of that is that the derivative of u becomes a simpler thing. So my differential du is just equal to d theta. The other part of the integral is what we call dv, and that's sine theta d theta. And we have to find the antiderivative to get v itself. That's negative cosine theta. And then our integral becomes u times v. That's negative theta cosine theta, evaluated from 0 to pi over 2, minus the integral of v du. And v is negative cosine theta. Why don't we just pull the minus sign out in front and cancel the one that's there? And I get cosine theta, and then du is just d theta. And I'll go ahead and evaluate the term on the left before I write down the next step. When I plug in pi over 2 for the upper limit, the cosine of pi over 2 is 0, so that term vanishes. But when I plug in 0 for the lower limit, theta is 0, so the term vanishes. So both of those terms are gone. Now I just need the antiderivative of the cosine function, which is just sine theta. And I evaluate this from 0 to pi over 2. And in the upper limit, I have the sine of pi over 2, which is 1. And in the lower limit, I have the sine of 0, which is 0. So we get a final value of 1 for the definite integral, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.